بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الصلاة والسلام على رسوله الكريم وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. There are very few people in the world who are known by one name. If you think about all the people you know and all the people we read about, generally you mention a name and there's some identification along with that name. For instance, Sufyan. You know, if you mention the name Sufyan, who are you talking about? You know, it depends what era you're talking about, contemporary era, classical era, and even in the classical era, Sufyan al-Thawri, Sufyan ibn Uyayna, and there are many others. Same thing if you mention the word Muhammad. You know, unless you're talking about the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, there are hundreds and thousands of people that come to mind. But there's very few people that you know on a first name basis, as the saying goes. When you know someone on a first name basis, generally it's someone that's close to you, a family member, or someone who's really close. So if you have a really good friend named Ashraf, so along your, you know, among your close contacts, you'll say Ashraf, and we all know, you know, the close people know who you're talking about. But how many people can we say that, you know, the entire ummah knows this particular person on a first name basis? Our personality today is one such person. She's a great Muslim woman by the name of Rabia. Rabia, most of us know who she was, or we've heard about her, and doesn't require an introduction, doesn't require the son of who, or the. In fact, people don't even know who her father was, what his name was, or other features about her life. So that's something about the renown about this great Muslim woman we're talking about today. Rabi'ah al-Adawiyya, al-Qaysiyyah, al-Basriyyah, various titles that she's known by. But she's most popular known simply by the first name, Rabi'ah. Rabi'ah is one of the most popular female names in the Muslim world. I think it's more true in the Indian subcontinent than in the Arab world. But there are many Arabs named Rabi'ah as well. All of us know someone who's named Rabi'ah. For instance, I come from a family of nine siblings. And the first child that we had was my older sister's niece, my older sister's daughter, and we named her Rabi'ah. And I'm sure all of us have someone in the family who's known by that name or know somebody with that name, especially if you come from India or Pakistan. So that gives you an idea before we even get into who this great personality was, how great she was, and what kind of influence and legacy she left. There are so many masajid in the world named after her. There are so many universities and institutions of learning named after her. There are hospitals named after her throughout the Muslim world. Many of the early writers and some of our greatest scholars, they talked about her and they praised her, including Sufyan al-Thawri, including Ibn al-Jawzi, including al-Dhahabi, including many, many other scholars. I'll share what one of the scholars said, and I think that's a sufficient introduction to her life. Fariduddin al-Attar was a biographer who wrote about her and as well as other people in his Tadhkiratul Awliya. So he says, after describing her, he said, إِذَا قَالَ شَخْصْ لِمَا ذَكَرْتَهَا بَيْنَ الرِّجَالِ. He said, if someone were to ask me, why did you mention her alongside men? You have this book of the awliya and all these great personalities, most of them men. He said, if someone were to ask me, why did you mention her alongside men? He said, أَقُولُ إِنَّ سَيِّدَ الْأَنْبِيَاءَ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ يقول. He said, I would say to them that the best or the master of the prophets, he said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَنْظُرُ إِلَىٰ سُوَرِكُمْ وَلَا إِلَىٰ أَجْسَامِكُمْ وَلَكِنْ يَنْظُرُ إِلَىٰ قُلُوبِكُمْ وَأَعْمَالِكُمْ. He said, I would relate to them the hadith where the prophet said, verily Allah does not look at your physical appearances. He does not look at your bodies. In other words, he doesn't look at your gender or who you are, but he looks at your hearts and he looks at your deeds. And then Fariduddin, he goes on to say, he says that وَفَلَوْ جَازَ الْإِلْمَامُ بِثُلُثَيِ الدِّينِ مِنْ عَائِشَةَ أَصْدِيقَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهَا لَجَازَتِ الْإِسْتِفَادُ مِنْ أَمَةٍ مِنْ إِمَائِهَا. He says, if it is allowed to take two-thirds of our religion from Aisha as-Siddiqa, the wife of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, if it is allowed to take two-thirds of our religion from her, what is he talking about? Obviously, how many hadiths were narrated by Aisha radiallahu anha? How much of our religion, how many of our rules and ahkam and our fiqh comes from her? So according to one estimation, two-thirds. So he says, if two-thirds of our religion can come from a woman, then surely we can benefit from one of the handmaids of Aisha radiallahu anha, who was Rabi'ah. So he says beautiful words about her. He says, you know, وَطَالَمَا كَانَتِ الْمَرْأَةِ رَجُلًا فِي طَرِيقِ اللَّهِ فَلَا يُمْكِنْ أَن تُسَمَّ امْرَأَةً. He said, if a woman were to walk in the path of Allah, in fi sabilillah, like a man, then she can no longer be called a woman. Then the gender becomes meaningless. So this is a sufficient introduction to the life of this great person who we are going to look at. She's described as hujjah qati'a ala ahli zaman, a proof, a decisive proof on the people of her time. She's known as shahidat al-ishq al-ilahi, the witness to the love of the divine. She's known as so many things, al-mustatira bi satar al-ikhlas, the woman who wore the garment or the hijab of ikhlas, al-muttaqida al-ishq wal-ishtiyaq, the one who was consumed by the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَمَفْتُونَ الْغَرَبُ وَالْإِحْتِرَاءُ, the one who was consumed and driven by a fire inside that drove her to worship and love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we're going to look at the life of this remarkable woman. And I have to begin with a small confession that the life of this particular person is very difficult to talk about for a number of reasons. Number one, she belongs, Rabi'ah al-Basriya, and her full name is Rabi'ah bint Ismail al-Basriya al-Qaysiyyah al-Adawiyya. She belongs to an early period of Islam prior to the time where books became popular. You know, there was written documentation. She's from the earliest generations of Islam, from the first three generations. So this is prior to the development of biographies and formal books about various individuals. So there's not a lot that's written from her time. Her earliest biographies, they begin about 100 years or some generations after her. So it's kind of difficult to look at the details of her life from that perspective. Number two, most of the documentation of this period focuses, rightfully so, on Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is the first three generations, the Salaf al-Salih. And you can imagine, this is the time when the companions are alive and they're passing away, and then the students of the companions are alive. What is the preoccupation of the Muslims at this time? They're concerned with preserving the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So most of the efforts in these early years have to do with writing down, preserving everything about Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So because of that, there wasn't a lot of effort and time spent on preserving the detailed biographies of the individuals who lived in this time period. And finally, and perhaps the biggest hurdle in understanding her life, is that Rabi'ah is one of those individuals in our history whose life is surrounded and even obscured by legend and false tales and tall tales. So she's one of those individuals that was so loved by her people that so many people said so many things about her that they added so many extra details, and so many incredible tales have been related about her. A lot of them, you know, don't stand the test of historical accuracy. But she's one of those lives, you know, you can see books and books written about her, but they're filled with inauthentic material. Material that doesn't make sense, and a lot of it obviously is fabricated. So because of that, it's difficult to sift through her life and separate fact from fiction. But at the same time, that doesn't preclude us from looking at her life and being inspired by her life, or anybody else's life, or anyone else's life for that matter. So I'll share with you some principles to keep in mind before discussing her life, and you can apply this to any biography. Number one, we have to keep in mind that biographies, when you look at the lives of human beings, you know, other than the prophets and other than the messenger of Allah, alayhi salatu wasalam, that's a different category. When you look at the biographies of men and women, you have to understand that they're meant to inspire us and to soften our hearts. They're not meant to lay down any legislation or definitive law. So when we read biographies, we don't read them like we read a book of fiqh, for instance, and come up with rulings of haram and halal and detailed things about our deen. But we look at the biographies to know these people, to increase in our love for them, to increase in our love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to soften our hearts and to inspire us. That's number one. Number two, second principle is that we have to keep in mind that no human being on the face of this earth is infallible, except for the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam, and all the prophets. And no book and no words that exist are infallible except the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran. So if we keep this principle in mind, it solves many of the difficulties that we come across reading these texts. Imam Malik has a beautiful qawl. He says, "Kullun yu'khad min qawlihi wa yurad illa Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam." He said, every human being from his life we take and we leave something. Every single person that exists, we take from his life and we leave from his or her life, except for Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. He's the only human being, we take everything from his life and we don't reject or leave anything. And Ibn Rajab, as we shared in our previous session, he says something very profound about books. So this is about human beings, about books. He says, وَيَأْبَ اللَّهُ الْعِصْمَةَ لِكِتَابٍ غَيْرَ كِتَابِ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ. He says that Allah, He refused to protect any single book except for His book in the world. So no single book in the world is protected in the way Allah protected, or with a guarantee of protection other than the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Ibn Rajab al-Hanbali, he says, وَالْمُنْسِفْ مَنْ اِغْتَرَفَ قَلِيلَ خَطَأِ الْمَرْءِ فِي كَثِيرِ صَوَابِهِ. But he says the fair one, the people who have fairness are the ones who take the majority of the correctness of every person and leave out the mistakes. And they leave out the few mistakes. So we don't reject people and say, you know, he made a mistake and we leave everything. But we look at things with justice. We look at every person and every book and everything that has been written with justice. You know, we take the good and we leave the bad. As the verse of the Quran that many of us, you know, we forget. If we apply this verse in our lives, it would make our lives much more meaningful. Allah says, أَلَّذِينَ يَسْتَمِعُونَ الْقَوْلَ وَيَتَّبِعُونَ أَحْسَنَ أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ هَدَاهُمُ اللَّهُ وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمْ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ. He says, describing the believers, they're those who, when they listen to something, when they hear something, they follow the best of what they hear. That means when they hear something, they take the best of what they hear, the best meaning and the best aspects of what they hear. أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ هَدَاهُمُ اللَّهُ. Then Allah describes these people with two characteristics. They are the ones who Allah guided. So they have the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they are the ones who are ulul albab. They are the ones who have intelligence, who reflect. So this is something, you know, we apply this to every single person, male or female. We take from their life the good, and we leave those things that are mistaken, and we ask Allah's forgiveness for the mistakes. Principle number three, when you look at the genre of virtues and merits, in Arabic, fada'il, when you talk about the virtues and merits or manaqib of a town or a region or a person or any group, you know, everything that's written in this particular genre is not meant to be taken quite literally, okay? So when you read virtues of various things, you know, a lot of things, there's a lot in the way of exaggeration in these works. Especially with those people who are very famous, the more famous a person is, the more this type of material tends to creep into their written legacy. And the same thing applies to poetry and many of the sayings of the scholars. So we have to keep that in mind when we discuss the virtues of anyone. You know, we don't look at things with quite a literal eye. We look at things that this was written, you know, many years later. Perhaps there's some wordings that were changed, and perhaps there's some exaggeration. And finally, the last two points, principle number four, is that every biography is subject to historical scrutiny. So as people of knowledge and people who follow evidence-based religion, we subject everything to historical scrutiny. And that's the manhaj, that's the methodology of the people of hadith and the people of all of our scholars who came before. They analyze everything historically. So they looked at when a person lived and when a person died, and they looked at, was it likely that this person met this person, and so on and so forth. And so everything that's written about any person, we subject it to historical critique. And the last principle, number five, and this is something that we have as believers, and non-Muslims don't necessarily share that with us, every biography we look at is also subject to the criterion of the Quran and the authentic Sunnah. So we as believers, we have a treasure. We have something that no other culture or tradition has. We have a book that Allah has revealed to us that's protected from error. It contains principles and guidance for us. And we have the authentic sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. So if we use those as a guide to look at any biography, any material, it'll help us sift through fact from fiction. And it helps us look at individuals in a more profound and meaningful way. So with that, let's talk about this great individual, this great woman, Rabi'a bint Ismail al-Adawiyya al-Qaysiyyah al-Basriya. She's known by many titles. Most of us know her as Rabi'a. But in the Arab world, she's known as Rabi'a al-Adawiyya from the tribe that she was affiliated with, or Rabi'a al-Qaysiyyah. In the Indian subcontinent, she's known more commonly as Rabi'a al-Basriya from the city of Basra, where she was born and she lived. Her laqab was Umm al-Khayr, and also she's attributed a laqab Umm Amr. And she was from which generation? One of the things we have to look at when we look at this time period, we define these individuals by looking at their generation. So she is from the generation of Atba' al-Tabi'in, the followers of the followers of the companions. Atba' al-Tabi'in. This is the third generation after the companions. What's significant about that? The significance is that she's still part of the Salaf, the golden generation of Islam. And we know the hadith of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, as narrated by Imran ibn Husayn in Bukhari and Muslim, where he says, "Khayrun nasi qarni, thumma alladhina yalunahum, thumma alladhina yalunahum." The Prophet said alayhi salatu wasalam, "The best of people is my generation," yani the companions. And then he said, "Thumma alladhina yalunahum," then those who follow the companions, and we call them the tabi'in. And then he added, "Thumma alladhina yalunahum," a second time, those who followed that generation, and they're called atba' al-tabi'in. So you have the sahaba, the tabi'in, the atba' al-tabi'in. And in some versions of this hadith that appear even in Muslim and Musnad Ahmad, the Prophet added it a third time, "Thumma alladhina yalunahum, thumma alladhina yalunahum," and then he added, "Thumma alladhina yalunahum." So according to some narrations, it includes three, and others includes four generations after the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. So Rabi' al-Basriya, she's from this golden generation, from the Salaf, from a generation that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam praised. She was born in the year 95 or in the year 99 of the Hijri calendar, which corresponds to 717 of the other calendar. This is roughly around the time period when the last companions were passing away. The last companion that died somewhere in the year 100 of the Hijri calendar, and in some reports 110. So she was at the end of the, you know, there are some companions that were alive, so although she did not meet them, she does not qualify as a tabi'i. So she qualifies as, so all her teachers were the tabi'in, the students of the companion. That's why she qualifies as atba' al-tabi'in. So she lived at, she was born at a time when Hassan al-Basri, the great imam, began teaching in Basra. So she was born the same year that he began to teach. We don't know much about her early life except a few things. One of the things we know about her life is that she was tested and tried. She lived a very difficult and very traumatic life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose her for trials and tests. She was born into an extremely poor family. It's described when she was born, the family did not have any oil in their house to light the lamp. So she was born in a time of extreme poverty. Even during her birth, they didn't have the material to take care of her. So that's, you know, she was tested in that respect. She was the fourth of four daughters. So her name, you know, what is the meaning behind her name? What is the significance? There's not much significance except that in Arabic, Rabi'a means the fourth, okay? So her father had four daughters. So he named one, second, number three. And when he had number four, you know, this is a poor family. They were preoccupied with other things. So the only thing he could think of, the fourth. So he named her Rabi'a. It's like, you know, if you were in like India or you know, suppose in Urdu, how would you say fourth? Jota, right? Or Jyoti. Imagine you had a daughter and you just named her Jyoti, you know, and that became her name. But, you know, look at the renown. Look, you know, just think for a moment, her father at that moment. Could he have imagined that one day her name would be mentioned throughout the world until the end of time? She would be part of the Islamic tradition. There would be masajid, there would be universities after her name. There would be many Muslim women named after Rabi'a throughout the world, hundreds and thousands of people. But this is the name that he chose for her. And Her father died shortly thereafter, so she was tested after that, and she became an orphan. So she was born in a poor family. That's one test. And then shortly after her birth, her father passed away, so she became an orphan, along with the rest of her sisters and her mother as well. So she had no one to take care of her. And not only that, shortly after that, there was a famine, a drought and a famine in Basra. So it affected most of the people, especially the poorer segments of society. And what happened, her sisters became scattered, so she lost her family. So she lost her parents, then she lost her sisters. And not only that, it got worse and worse. She became she suffered trial after trial in her life. And if you think about the trials that she suffered, and you can only imagine if we were to go through something like that, you know, what would that do to our faith, and how would it shake us? And you know, the hadith of the Prophet, مَنْ يُرِدِ اللَّهُ بِهِ خَيْرًا يُصِبْ مِنْ, that whoever Allah desires good for, He tests them, He chooses them for trials and tribulations. So she's born in a poor family. Her father died and she became an orphan. She lost her sisters. Then there was a famine, and eventually she was captured and sold into slavery. So can you imagine? That's probably the worst thing you can think of that can happen to a human being. So eventually she wound up a slave. She was born free, but eventually she found herself sold into slavery. Not only that, she was sold, in the books of history, it's written that she was sold for a measly price of 6 dirhams. Can you imagine 6 dirhams? They sold her for a paltry sum. It's exactly like Yusuf alayhi salam, when Allah describes what happened to him in the well. وَشَرَوْهُ بِثَمَنٍ بَخْسٍ دَرَاهِمَ مَعْدُودًا. Doesn't Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, they sold him for a paltry sum, a few measly dirhams, دَرَاهِمَ مَعْدُودًا. So when you think about that, that's an additional element of trial. That, you know, one thing is that, you know, you're respected and you're sold for a large amount, but imagine you're taken. So look at Yusuf. Who was Yusuf alayhi salam, a prophet of Allah? And look at his beauty, a beautiful specimen of a human being, someone with such physical beauty, and he's sold for such a measly price. That confounds the trial and the tribulation. So similarly with Rabi'ah, she was sold into slavery. And in these difficult times, you know, we might be shaken in our faith, but what happened to her, she became stronger and stronger in her faith. And she's someone who's known for worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala until the end of time. So what happened was, in these difficult circumstances, they only made her stronger. And she became such a worshiper. She discovered a life that very few people had at that time, and people would envy her for that. She discovered the beauty and the joy of worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in these difficult times, you know, circumstances, that makes all the more sense. Someone who's well off, you know, and he worships Allah has a different meaning. That's someone who's lost everything, lost his parents, lost all his support and family, and then becomes a slave. All of these trials after trial, there was nothing left for her in the world. So she found Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and she began to worship Him. She discovered the same thing that Ibn Taymiyyah, Shaykh al-Islam, he talked about. He said, "Man lam yadkhul inna fid dunya jannah, man lam yadkhulha lam yadkhul jannat al-akhirah." He said something beautiful, that in this world there is a paradise. Whoever doesn't enter that paradise will not enter the paradise of the next world. And that's the paradise of knowing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and worshiping Him. So eventually she began to live a life of worship. She began to worship Allah during the night, pray to Him, make dua. She was known for her worship. And she left the world. She had no need for the world. And even everyone around her began to notice. And eventually her tides began to turn. So the person who owned her, he left her alone when he found that there's nothing he can do with her, that she can't be of benefit to him. All she did was pray all night and fast during the day. So eventually he set her free when he saw this example. And then she found a secluded place for herself, and she began to worship, and she began to make dua, and she began to inspire people. And people began to notice at this point in her life. So she earned the notice of many, many people, and her fame began to rise. And people would visit her for knowledge and for blessings and for barakah. She began to interact with some of the leading personalities of her age, including religious scholars such as Sufyan al-Thawri, such as Ibrahim ibn Adham, such as even political figures like the governors of her time began to write letters to her. So she became famous in her lifetime for giving up the dunya and worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. She had nothing else. There are many things written about her interacting with Hassan al-Basri, rahimahullahu ta'ala. So if you read her biographies, there's so much written about her and Hassan al-Basri. Sometimes even it looks like there's an element of romance going on. But this particular aspect of life does not withstand historical scrutiny. We mentioned she was born the year 95 or 99. Hassan al-Basri died in the year 110 of the Hijri calendar. So he died when she was perhaps 10 years old, maximum 15 years old. So it's unlikely that they interacted. This is a very young age, she had a difficult childhood, and she became, you know, famous towards the end of her life. But yet when you read some of the history books or the biographies, you'll find all these tall tales of her speaking with Hassan al-Basri, even him proposing to her, and so on and so forth. Even on her deathbed, the tales say that, you know, Hassan al-Basri visited her and said some things. So, you know, this is not accurate. This is the part that is not accurate. She's also said to have interacted with the famous Dhunnun al-Misri, was a famous Sufi, early Sufi ascetic from Egypt. That also is not corroborated. As well as Malik bin Dinar. Malik bin Dinar was one of the students of Hassan al-Basri, one of his disciples. And he died very shortly after Hassan al-Basri. So it is said that she interacted with him as well. Allahu ta'ala a'lam. During her life, many people proposed to her. You know, here's a Muslim woman, she became famous, so many people proposed to her, and she refused all the proposals. She was not interested in marriage. Among the people that proposed to her was Muhammad bin Sulaiman, who was the governor of Basra. He offered her even a dowry of 100,000 dinars. And he told her, you know, how much he makes, and he offered everything to her. And she said to him, "It doesn't please me that you become my slave. And it doesn't please me that everything you possess becomes mine, or that you should distract me from God or from Allah for even a single moment." So she rejected that proposal. Another pious person, Abdul Wahid ibn Zayd, who died the year 793 of the Christian calendar, he proposed and she refused with the words, "O sensual one, seek another sensual one like yourself, for have you seen any sign of desire in me?" So she was someone who just, her life was consumed by worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So she rejected all of these different proposals. She rejected people who would offer a house to live in, people who would offer material possessions, and so on and so forth. During her life, she made the Hajj to Mecca one time at least. And there is a lot narrated about her pilgrimage, but most of it appears to be legend. What we can say about her life is that she was drawn to a life of poverty. She didn't choose, she chose a life of poverty. She didn't want to live in a life of luxury. She rejected gifts, she rejected material possessions, and so on and so forth. The people who visited her described that her only material possessions in the world were like a water jug to make wudu and so on and so forth, a prayer mat, and a brick. And some of the students, they visited her, they said they would find her sleeping on that mat, that reed mat, and the brick would be her pillow. This was Rabi' al-Basariyah, rahimahullah ta'ala. She spent the last 7 years of her life, she moved with her female companions to Quds, the Holy Land in Palestine. And she lived atop Mount Tur, the Mount Tur in the Sinai Peninsula. And there she would descend every night, every day, teaching people and worshipping, and people would come and be inspired from her company. She died in her mid-80s and is buried somewhere in the Mount of Olives in the year 180 or the year 185 of the Hijri calendar. Some of the accounts mentioned that her date of death was 135, but that doesn't appear to be accurate. So she died either 180 or 185 of the Hijri calendar, rahimahullahu ta'ala. That corresponds to 801 of the Christian era. Now, I wanted to share some of the things about her life. You know, there are so many beautiful accounts and stories about her life. There are so many beautiful statements and aqwal from her, beautiful prayers that she used to make. So some of these are really inspiring. So some points about her life. One of the points I wanted to start out by mentioning that she was an individual that transcended gender. When you read her life and you look at her legacy in the world, you know, this is not someone who you look at as a Muslim woman. You know, her, a Muslim woman that lived, you know, doing womanly things and whose life was for Muslim women. Her life was for everyone. And all the greatest individuals in our history were inspired by her. So she lived a life that transcended gender. Some people live above boundaries and above certain demarcations. She was one of those. When it comes to gender interactions, unfortunately in our world, in our time, there's a lot of tension in male-female dynamics. There's a lot of tension between, on the one hand, those who consider women to be fitna, and they consider women to be a trial, and a woman who needs to be suppressed and hidden behind doors, and so on and so forth. There are people who think like that. And on the other hand, there are people who feel as a reaction that women need to be equal in everything. So in everything that men do, women have to do, and so there's always this clash. When you look at the Islamic tradition, you see that there's no tension, such tension in the early times. There may be in our times today, but in the early times, Muslim men and women were totally equal. The Quran does not distinguish between men and women. In the Quran, men and women are equals. Allah says, Ya ayyuhan nas, inna khalaqnakum min dhakarin wa untha, wa ja'alnakum shu'uban wa qabaila lita'arafu. Verse after verse, Allah mentions that all human beings, they come from one man and one woman. Allah mentions the beautiful stories of the prophets as examples for everyone, men and women. And he even mentions the examples of the women, you know, the pious women. And what does he say about them? We'll mention just one verse in Surah Tahrim, where Allah mentions two Muslim women, two women who are examples. He says, وَضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا امْرَأَةَ فِرْعَوْنَ إِذْ قَالَتْ رَبِّ ابْنِي لِي عِنْدَكَ بَيْتًا فِي الْجَنَّةِ. Allah is talking about the wife of Fir'aun and the mother of Isa alayhi salam. But what does he say? Allah says, and Allah gives an example for the people who believe. Allah doesn't say Allah gives an example for women. Allah doesn't say He gives an example for men. He says, and there's an example Allah gives for all people who believe in the wife of Fir'aun when she said, إِذْ قَالَتْ رَبِّ بِنِ لِي عِنْدَكَ بَيْتًا فِي الْجَنَّةِ. She said a beautiful prayer. She said, O Allah, build for me with you a house in paradise. She was someone who was very similar to Rabiah al-Basrah. She was one who worshipped Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and her husband was Fir'aun. Can you imagine? Her husband was one of the most evil people that ever lived, and his wife is one of the most pious people that ever lived. And you can see from her dua, her beautiful supplication, that she says, رَبِّ بِنِ لِي عِمْدَكَ بَيْتًا فِي الْجَنَّةِ. O my Lord, build for me with you, next to you, a house in paradise. She doesn't say, O Allah, build for me a house next to you in paradise. See the difference? Build for me a house next to you in paradise. She's thinking first about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As the proverb goes, Al-Jaru qabla ad-dar, that the neighbors, they come before your house. So she's thinking about where her house is going to be. So she says, رَبِّ بِنِ لِي عِنْدَكَ بَيْتًا فِي الْجَنَّةِ. Oh my Lord, build for me next to you a house in paradise. So the point here is that in our tradition, all believers follow Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they're examples for everyone. We don't distinguish it between men and women. We don't distinguish between men and women. So Rabi' al-Basriya wasn't such person. Her example is for everyone. So we shouldn't look at the men and teach the men that this is your example, and the women, we shouldn't have this separation that exists in our times. Another thing about her life is her sincerity. She's someone who had a very high standard of sincerity. So one of the things that she used, there's a beautiful statement of her. She says, "Uktumu hasanatikum kama taktumuna sayyi'atikum." She said, you should conceal your good deeds as much as you conceal your evil deeds, your sins. So she believed that good deeds needed to be concealed. And when she saw that one of her good deeds were known in public and someone found out, she considered that she had no value in that. She did not even consider that a deed. So she said, for instance, another quote, what appears of any good works, I count as nothing as all. So she used to worship Allah in privately. She wasn't one who stood in public and gave sermons. She preferred to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in private. And she had many du'as and supplications she used to make. One time, Sufyan al-Thawri, he said to her, "Alas for my sorrow." And she answered to him, "Do not lie, but rather you should say, 'Alas for my lack of sorrow.'" She said, "If you were truly sorrowful, then you would not be, then this dunya, this world would have no delight for you." So she had a very high standard when it came to ikhlas or sincerity. Another feature about her life is that you could tell from her statement that she had a sense of urgency of time. So she would say to, one time she said to Sufyan al-Thawri,
إِنَّمَا أَنْتَ أَيَّامٌ مَعْدُودَةٌ فَإِذَا ذَهَبَ يَوْمٌ ذَهَبَ بَعْضُ.
She said, you are only a few days. Your life is just a number of days. Every time one of the days passes, a part of you is gone forever. So she says, يُوشِكُ إِذَا ذَهَبَ الْبَعْضُ أَنْ يَذْهَبَ الْكُلُ وَأَنْتَ تَعْلَمْ فَأْعْمَلْ. She said, when part of you goes, one day all of you will go. So you should work and work for that day. One time, one of her servants, one of her companions, Abda bint Abi Shuwal, she said that she saw, you know, she's the one who described many of her personal worship and her characteristics. And these are found in the narrations with Isnad. So Abda bint Abi Shuwal, she says, and she was a pious person herself, that every night she would spend the entire night in prayer. And then when the time for Fajr came close, she would lie down just for a few moments and sleep or take a rest for a few moments. And then she would get up and pray Fajr. And then she would fast during the days. So she said, one of those nights I noticed that when she fell asleep, I noticed she suddenly got up in a startled state. And she jumped up and she proclaimed, Ya nafsi kam tanamin, ila kam taqulin, yushiku an tanami nawmatan la tafuqina minha illa liyawmin nushur. She said, O soul, how long will you sleep? How often will you wake? Soon you are going to sleep a slumber from which you shall never awake until the day of resurrection. And from that moment she began to pray. So she was always in that state of hurry when it came to worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. She was also, one of the things she emphasized to her disciples and those who asked her for advice is repentance. That had a very high status in her worship, repenting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So one of the things she used to say, istighfar, she used to say, astaghfirullah min qillati sidqi fi qawli astaghfirullah. She says, she used to say, I seek, O Allah, forgive me, astaghfirullah, from my lack of sincerity in saying astaghfirullah. So this is the way her mind worked, that she was always into istighfar and tawbah. She was very close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When one time someone came to her and asked her, make dua for me, asking her, you know, to make dua, she said, who am I? Who am I to make dua? You should obey your Lord and pray to him, for he will answer the supplicant when he supplicates. So there are many, many things narrated about her zuhud, and her leaving the world is very famous. There are many, many incidents. We'll share just a few. One time a man came to her and gave her 40 dinars. And he said, here, this is for you. Spend it on anything that you need. So she rejected it, of course, that was her habit. She began to cry. She said to him on that day, and he remembered, and it became documented. She says, Allah knows that I'm ashamed to ask him for anything of this dunya, and he rules the whole dunya. He owns the dunya. So how can I take it from someone who doesn't even own it, who doesn't even rule over the dunya? On another occasion, two religious leaders visited her. And, you know, as people would, prominent personalities would visit her, and they were very hungry, and they, you know, one of the intentions they had, we'll visit her, and perhaps there'll be some food that we can eat from. And we know that any food in her presence will be from a lawful source. So that's what they were looking for. So they sat down, so a cloth was laid out before them. And then there were two loaves of bread there. And then while they're sitting, looking at the bread, a beggar came. And then Rabia, she gave the bread to the beggar as sadaqah. And then they saw the bread, it was lifted from their presence and it went away. And they were very frustrated, so they didn't say anything. Then they described some moments passed, and a person came with a sack full of hot bread. So someone had sent a gift. And she came and gave it to Rabia and said, this is from my mistress. And she put it on the floor. Rabia, she looked at the bread, she counted the loaves. There were 18 loaves of bread. And she said to her, you know, this is not mine. Go back. So she wrapped up and tied it up and sent it back. And, you know, that person tried very hard. No, this is for you. But Rabia would not accept. So that person went away. And after some moments, that same person came back with the loaf, with the sack of bread. And then, you know, brought it back to Rabia. And she opened it up. Now there were 20. So that person said, you know what? My master, she gave me 20 loaves of bread to give to you. But I was hungry, so I kept two for myself. So Rabia says, okay, now you spoke the truth, this is for us. And then she served those to their guests, and they all ate from the bread. And then they asked her, what happened? How did you know? You know, what happened here? She said, you know, when I had the two loaves of bread, you know, I wanted to present it to the guests, but there wasn't enough food.
And then I saw the beggar, and that was an opportunity. So I gave the bread to the beggar, and I made dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I said, Ya Allah, you say, you know, you promise, لِلْحَسَنَاتِ عَشْرُ أَمْثَالِهَا. You promise that every good deed multiplied by 10. So 10 for every one good deed. So then she gave this in sadaqah with that intention that she would get more. And she said, I know Allah's words are true. 100%, I have full yaqeen. And I knew there would be 20, you know, pieces of bread that would be coming back. When I saw 18, I knew there was a problem. So this is Rabiah of Basrah, rahimahullah ta'ala. But perhaps the most famous thing she's known for is her love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So she's one who, if she had a contribution to the ummah, it would be reviving this concept of loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, this is something that sometimes we neglect, and oftentimes, you know, we don't really approach it properly. As Allah says in the Quran, وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَتَّخِذُ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ أَنْدَادًا يُحِبُّونَهُمْ كَحُبِّ اللَّهِ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبًّا لِلَّهِ. Allah says, and we'll summarize, that those who believe, they love Allah more than anything else. So they're very extreme in their love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, you know, loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is something very important. It's part of our iman. It's something Ibn al-Qayyim describes at some length in his works. It's one of the fruits of worship. It's the food for the souls. But it's something sometimes we forget. Sometimes we get into a routine and we start, you know, doing things, and, you know, it becomes like a labor. But we forget the essence, the ruh, the spirit, which is loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So she is someone who revived that. She always taught that. And if you look at her life, it's really love that sustained her in these difficult times. So she would say during the night when she would be praying, one of the du'as she would make, Ilahi anarat al-nujum ونامت العيون وأغلقت الملوك أبوابها وخلع كل حبيب بحبيبه وهذا مقامي بين يديه. She would say, Oh my Lord, the stars are shining, the eyes of all men are closed, the kings have shut their doors, and every lover is with his or her beloved, and here I am alone with you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is Rabi' al-Basriya rahimahullahu ta'ala. And there's a lot that can be said about her. There are many more incidents. There's also a lot of questionable material related about her life, and I'll share some at the end just to give a complete picture of her life. You know, there are many things that are said about her that are by way of exaggeration or are untrue. One of the authors, Uwaymar Anjum, in Al-Jumar magazine, he says something very, he's talking about someone else, but it's the same quote can be applied, and I wanted to quote his statement. That many of these reports can be seen as examples of the kind of myths created by unscrupulous writers around admired teachers. So you have unscrupulous writers and admired teachers. So when someone becomes so admired and so famous, then people, you know, everyone adds their details, and some people, they don't have the best, you know, character and integrity in mind. So they add details and they exaggerate. So he says, especially in the domain of preaching and spirituality, people have allowed themselves a free rein of imagination, which has led to much fabrication and misattribution. So in the case of Rabi'ah, many things are said about her. One of the things that is said about her is her concept of Jannah and Jahannam. So one thing she used to say is that we don't worship Allah, or reportedly she said, we don't worship Allah for Jannah or Jahannam. We worship Allah because He deserves to be worshipped. So she said, for instance, مَثَلُ الْعَابِدْ لِلْجَنَّةِ أَوِ النَّارُ كَمَثَلِ أَجِيلُ السَّوْءِ. She said that the ones who worship paradise and worship hellfire, in other words, they worship so they can get paradise and they worship to avoid hellfire, they're like the workers of evil, those who employ in a haram business, or so on and so forth. There's a famous dua that's quoted to this day about her, where she reportedly said, and I'll say it in English, Oh my Lord, if I worship you from fear of hellfire, burn me in hellfire. And if I worship you from fear of paradise, or fear of losing paradise, then exclude me from paradise. But if I worship you for your own sake, then do not withhold from me your eternal beauty. So this is a dua that's still circulated to our times. But, you know, obviously, our criterion is the Quran and Sunnah. It's unlikely that she said that someone of her caliber would have said such a thing, because if you look at the Quran, that's our criteria. The Quran is filled with verses inspiring us to aim for Jannah. سَابِقُوا إِلَى مَغْفِرَةٍ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ وَجَنَّةٍ عَرْضُهَا السَّمَاوَاتُ وَالْأَرْضُ, where Allah says, race, rush to the forgiveness of your Lord and to the paradise whose expanse is as wide as the heavens and the earth. So there's no, you know, the dichotomy between worshipping Allah and desiring paradise. It's one and the same. If you look at the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, how many times did he inspire his companions, do this and you will get Jannah. And people ask, will I get Jannah? Will I do? And all the companions, they aim for Jannah. So this is an Islamic value. So this is likely something that crept in later. This is one of the things to keep in mind. There's another tall tale that one day they saw Rabia running in the street. She had some fire, a fire lit in one hand and a jug of water in the other hand. She's running. So they asked her, what are you doing? She's saying, I'm running. I'm going to take this fire and I'm going to burn paradise, Jannah. And I'm going to take this water and I'm going to blow out the fire of hell so people stop worshipping, you know, heaven and hell. So, you know, and then she said, reportedly says some verses of poetry. So, you know, this is something that's a wrong understanding. There's online, there's a beautiful lecture by Sheikh Abu Ishaq al-Khuwaini where he mentions that, you know, this is stems from a wrong understanding of Jannah and Jahannam. You know, this is an understanding people have that perhaps Jannah is something that's just physical and it's filled with physical pleasures. So they deem it unbecoming of a believer just to work for that, just to be a sensual and physical person. But these people forget, Jannah is not just about that. The greatest na'im, the greatest pleasure of Jannah is seeing the vision of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if you want to see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Jannah is the way to do it. So that's, you know, it's not just a place of physical pleasures. But beyond the physical pleasure, the greatest pleasure is seeing the face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another thing she said about the Kaaba, for instance, Ibn Taymiyyah in a fatwa, he writes that this statement is a lie attributed to her. She said about the Kaaba, إِنَّهُ الصَّنَمُ الْمَعْبُودُ فِي الْأَرْضِ, that the Kaaba is an idol that's worshipped in the earth. In other words, people are worshipping the Kaaba, they should be worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you can see many of these concepts are coming from other traditions. You know, the only biography of Rabia is in the English language written by a non-Muslim, Margaret Smith. I have it here. So, you know, there are a lot of parallels between the legends around her life and the legends around the life of the Buddha, for instance, or the life of different saints in the Christian tradition. So, you know, there's different traditions and many of these things creep into the tradition later on. So these are some of the things. Among the things that's about her is that she used to fast for entire weeks, you know, without breaking her fast, 7 days without eating or drinking or sleeping. Obviously, that's not Islamic and that's prohibited, so we don't believe those tales. There are a lot of things that are attributed between her and Hassan al-Basri, for instance. So, and as we mentioned, you know, she probably likely never met him. If she met him, it was a small child, as a small child. So there's a famous tale, and it's still many of the Sufi books, they mention these tales. That one day Hassan al-Basri sees Rabia sitting by a lake. So, you know, one of the things about this time period that people believed in miracles and that was something to prove your wealth, you know, your worth, and if you were a wali, you had to have a miracle. And this obviously comes from other traditions outside of Islam. So Hassan al-Basri, he sees Rabia, reportedly sees Rabia sitting by a lake. So he takes out his janmas, his musalla, and he throws it on the water. And he said, Rabia, come join me in salah on the water. To, you know, just to show the miracle that the musalla stays afloat on the water and they can pray. And then the tradition says that Rabia, she took her musalla, threw it in the air and started floating. And she said, you think that's something? Come join me up here and let's make two rak'ahs up here. And then she said to him, you know what, but in the end, these things are nothing. It's really what you do with your life. These are just tricks. So there are many things related about that. About the Hajj, for instance, when she made the Hajj, there are three things mentioned about the Hajj. One is that when she was making the Hajj, she was on her donkey. And on the journey, the donkey died. And then she fell off the donkey and she had her luggage. So all the people came to her help. Let's help you. She said no. She refused any help. She said, I've given a pledge many years ago never to accept help from anyone. So then she made dua. She's left alone in the desert. She made dua to Allah. Oh Allah, you know, even the kings don't do this with their servants. You know, a wretched, poor slave, they don't treat them like this. I'm responding to your call. I'm saying labbaik. And this is what you do to me. Then the donkey comes back to life.
she goes back on it, and she goes and makes the Hajj, and eventually the story said they found this donkey living many years later. Another thing about the Hajj, she's making the Hajj, and halfway to the Hajj, the Kaaba comes out and meets her. And then she, you know, when she sees the Kaaba, she says, you know, I have no need for you. I'm there to meet the Lord of the Kaaba. You are nothing to me. And then the Kaaba returns to his position. It's also narrated that Ibrahim ibn Adham, another great early Muslim, that he spent 14 years reaching Mecca in order to make Hajj. Why? Because he, when he made the journey to Hajj, he decided to every place of prayer, every musalla, every masjid on the way, he's going to pray. So in that way, it took him 14 years to reach the Kaaba. And when he reached Mecca, he found the Kaaba was missing. And he asked people, what happened? What happened? You know, am I sick or something? Am I blind? They said, no, the Kaaba has gone to meet a woman. And then he became very angry. Who's this woman the Kaaba has gone to meet? And then he turns around, he sees Rabiah coming, and the Kaaba is coming alongside her. And he says, you know, what is this disturbance, O Rabiah? What are you doing to the world? And she says, yeah, rather it's you who's disturbing the world, spending 14 years to come to the Kaaba. And he says, I was spending that time in prayer. She says, you were spending that time in ritual prayer while I was doing personal supplication to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are some of the tall tales, you know, that are about not only her life, but all the early Muslims. You'll find many of these tall tales. We as Muslims, as people who believe in evidence-based religion, you know, we love and respect everyone, especially from the golden generations. And we take the good and we leave those things that are not attributable to these personalities. So this is, in a nutshell, something about the life of this great individual, Rabi'a al-Basriya al-Adawiyya. May Allah enable all of us to walk in her footsteps and learn some of the lessons from her life. If there's anything that inspires her from her life or anybody else's life, as I always mention, we should take a moment, make dua that Allah bless their souls, Allah increase their ranks in Jannah, and Allah add all of our rewards, everything that we do to their rewards. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ. With that, if there's any questions or comments, we'll open the floor. Okay, we need first. Also, if there's sisters here, they can come to in the front of the elevator, and you can remove that curtain. And if you want to ask questions, this is about Rabi'ah. It is about a Muslim woman, and you know from their life that there was this natural interaction. We should have more of that, inshallah. So feel free to ask questions. Yes. Okay, the question about the education of Rabi'ah, she's not known to be like a scholar in the sense of scholar. So she's not known to be like following the footsteps of like say the muhaddithin or the people of Quran. So there's nothing written in her life about that. She was a worshiper. So you find in, you know, the lesson for me in that is that there are different capacities for every human being. Not everyone has to be a muhaddith and memorizing all the hadith of the Prophet or memorizing the Quran. Everyone has different capacities, but everyone needs to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it appears from her life that she wasn't, there's no written book that she left. She did not narrate any hadith. She did not have any formal teachers and formal students. So she didn't follow that line of knowledge or seeking knowledge. But she was a worshiper of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yet she still interacted with people who are worshiping. Yes, you can just move the curtain all the way. Jazakumullah.
Yes.
Exactly, yes.
He was reminding the people in Sham during the time of Muawiyah, and then, you know, all the luxury, all the.
Exactly, yes.
He goes to the market, and then, you know, there was a very problematic, right? And they reported to the Khalifa, and then they actually requested him to take him back. During the time of, I believe, Uthman,
I believe, yes.
So, I mean, but there, other Sahabas, I mean, they relate to one of the hadith that when during one of the expeditions, Rasulullah was going, I think it's when Tabuk, he was behind. And then he mentioned something that he came, he will be alone and something. And then when he died, actually, he was alone in the desert. So, I mean, so doesn't that put a principle? that there could be certain individuals, they have certain quality in them, which is very good, but at the same time, that shouldn't be the general quality or principle for the Muslims. So in terms of the ibadah, we take the ibadah of the Rasulullah who said that, I do ibadah, I do worship, and also I get married. I do sleep, and then I work for worship. I do fast, and I prepare the first. So, I mean, if we, I think that exaggeration, what happened is that, as you said, in the subcontinent, I mean, I grew up in that, I mean, you can find Rabiah here and there.
Yeah.
Rabiah of Basrah, right? This influence of sometimes what fails you that you kind of go back, not to even study hard, you know what I mean? Like, the exaggeration is that we don't go for zuhud in that term, that we have to live through this life, right? That's our test. It's not that you go to the jungle and then they start worshiping, and that's not the purpose of Muslims. Your purpose is that these are the tests, you get married, you get children, and that's your test. And then even then you can work up for that. If you don't have children and have husband or wife, and then you work up for whole day, I mean, that you are fine, man, you are single, but have children and try to do tahajjud, see how you can do that. And that's the test from Allah SWT. And that should be the Muslim, right? And it's...
Everyone heard his nice comments? Everyone heard Brother Munir? Yeah. Yes, sister, you have a question?
Yes, I had a similar question back then.
Okay.
Awesome.
Okay, very good. So the both questions or comments are very similar, and I agree with them. They're not really questions. Brother Munir mentioned that even in the time of the companion, you'll find, you know, different companions had different capacities. So Abu Dharr al-Ghifari radiallahu anhu was someone who kind of leaned towards renouncing the world and not being part of the, you know, the politics and part of accepting material possessions. And he would always remind people harshly that give up the dunya. To such an extent that the other companions found it very difficult being around him. So eventually he was banished. In a friendly way, he was told, you know what, go live on the outskirts and leave us alone. And that's how he spent the rest of his life. So, you know, and Brother Muni mentioned, the sister mentioned the same thing. The example of the Prophet, alayhi salatu wasalam, is that, you know, you live in this world, you have to, the sunnah of the Prophet, as he said, النِكَاحُ سُنَّتِي فَمَنْ رَغِبَ عَنْ سُنَّتِي فَلَيْسَ مِنِّي, that my marriage is my sunnah, and whoever doesn't follow my sunnah, he's not from me. So we don't take these points of example. That's why I mentioned in the introduction that when you look at biographies, they're not meant to lay down law. They're not meant to give us directives what to do with our lives. Biographies are just meant to inspire us. So there are many people that didn't marry. Now, we're not here to judge those individuals. We can say that the sunnah of the Prophet is to get married. All of us need to make an attempt to get married and to contribute to the world and not live off other people. But regarding specific individuals, we should step back and be a little humble and say, you know, we're not, you know, Allah is responsible for judging human beings, not us. But we look at whatever good anybody left us, we take the good and we leave the bad. There could be many circumstances about our life we don't know about. For instance, Ibn Taymiyyah never married. Imam Nawawi never married. Sayyid Qutb never married. Many of our greatest scholars never married. Are you going to say that these people are not following the sunnah and we leave everything they did? No. There are reasons for that. So the predominant sunnah is to get married and to live in the world, but there could be circumstances that prevent that. You know, there may be a shortage of women or a shortage of men in some instances, or there may be economic reasons people cannot get married, and that's true in many parts of the world today. So we don't judge people. That's the point. We step back and we love all of our Muslim brothers, especially those who passed before us, and we say, Allahu Ta'ala, Allah forgive them for any mistakes they may have made. But what we follow is the Quran and the Sunnah, and we look at these individuals to inspire us to live better lives and to live lives under the guidance of Quran and Sunnah. Wallahu A'lam. Yes. You want to take it?
This is a question.
Okay.
It's a question. discussed. But you mentioned some things that, you know, some things have been narrated about her, but very likely these are not authentic and so on. Mm-hmm. On what basis do you say that? I mean, at least there should have been established, maybe just to say that, there should be some aspects of her life that are authentic. Right?
Okay.
How do we know that she understood the principles of the Quran, for example, so if something that is narrated about her that contradicts those principles, we have the right to say that she would not have been doing that. Are there the sources that show anything like that?
That's a very good question. It requires someone who does a lot of research. How do we sift through, sifting through the authentic versus the inauthentic? So I mentioned some principles that come to my mind based on my research. So those principles included historical scrutiny. So for that, we eliminate Hassan al-Basri's instance because of the dates of death. The dates of death are pretty accurate because in our Islamic tradition, generally, people were very keen to what happened in different years. And generally, that's the way of identifying scholars and personalities, what year they died. So they're fairly accurate. So from that perspective, we eliminate many things. So if you look at that filter, that eliminates some of the things. If you look at the filter of the Quran and Sunnah, that eliminates other things, but that leaves a question, as you said, could it be that she said that, she just was mistaken, and she didn't know that the Quran said this on that? Perhaps. Or could it be that someone later added to that? It's quite obvious, I think, when you look at, if you analyze, like some of the miracle stories, for instance, and you look at the stories, they're exact identical stories that are related with St. Augustine or some other personality in other traditions. So then, in that respect, a historian can look at that and say, you know what, this story is coming from a Christian source, and someone added it to make, you know, give her the same status as the Christian source or the Buddha source. Like, there's a story about the Buddha. You know, his name was starts with a G, okay. So there's a story about him that's almost identical to a story that's related about Rabiah. So at least this historian, Margaret Smith, she says that likely this came from the Buddhist source, which is basically she was cooking one day and she needed one onion to complete the. So she sent her servant out and, you know, they couldn't find an onion, so a bird came and she dropped an onion that was fully peeled from the sky into the pot. You know, there's stuff like that written about the Buddha as well. Exactly almost the same story. So in all likelihood, this is coming from those sources. And you also have to look at history, the development of Sufism, mysticism. You know, Rabia is a figure that's considered to be one of the founders of Sufism, although that's not true. She lived at a time way before the Sawuf or this movement developed. So because they appropriated her as a foundational figure, you find in different movements of mysticism, people claiming Rabia did this or claiming Rabia, many of them diametrically opposed to each other. So some of the things she believed that Allah and the creation were one, and that is said about her as well. So when we see that, we can see that this developed historically later, and this group claims she did that, and there's no solid historical evidence that she did. So this is like a historical analysis. Unfortunately, in the life of Rabia, not a lot of effort was spent in her biography because she didn't leave any of the written work. When you look at the life of Sufyan ibn Uyayna and the life of different muhaddithin, scholars came and they verified and they authenticated their information. They looked at all the stuff that was written about them, that particular person. But because she wasn't famous in that respect as a scholar, so generally people neglected her. So what are the biographies that mention her? The earliest one is Fariduddin ibn al-Attar, who was a person inclined to tasawwuf, so he mentioned many of these tall tales. And then there's, and he wrote this in Persian, by the way. So many of her earliest biographies are written in Persian, not even written in Arabic. So, and then later on, you know, there wasn't a great effort to corroborate some of these things. So the only statement I came across of Ibn Taymiyyah about this particular thing that is makdub alayha, that is, it's a lie attributed to her. What basis did he judge that on? Allahu alam. But in the other instances of her divine love, scholars generally, they say this statement is incorrect. If she said it, it's a mistake. If she didn't say it, it's a false thing attributed later to her. And obviously all those fancy tales of flying and things like that, those are stuff people added later on.
Similarly, this, I don't know where mentioned it as one of the authentic stories about her, the 20 loaves, the 18 loaves. Mm-hmm. That is mentioned among others also, other people.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, exactly. And this quote, innama yabna Adam, innama anta ayyam, kulluma, every day, you're a bunch of days, is from Hassan al-Basri, and it's from others as well. So you'll find a lot of this in the early literature. So at the end of the day, that's why I said that in the very beginning. Biographies are meant to inspire us, but we don't say anything definitively. We can't say for sure any of this happened. We know basic facts that she lived at this time period, life of poverty. So I mentioned that synopsis. But I ignored a lot of the details because we never really know. At the end of the day, we will never know. But it doesn't really matter. She's not Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi. He's the only man that we take everything from. We need to know everything about his life and the life of the companions and his wives. But everyone else, Allahu ta'ala, there's always going to be this indecisiveness, this ambiguity. And that's the way it should be, because we should focus on only one person exclusively. Everyone else is just meant to follow in those footsteps. And if they help us doing that, Allahu Akbar. If they don't, then the blame is not on those personalities, but on us. Allahu A'lam. Any other? Okay. Our Isha prayer is 9:45, right? We have 5 minutes.
سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد ان لا اله الا انت نستغفرك ونتوب اليك